Hello everybody and welcome to this video in which I shall introduce the causal perturbation expansion which gives a way to actually compute the kernel of the fermionic projector and is the starting point for a detailed explicit analysis. The setting we consider is an external field in Minkowski space, thus the Dirac operator has the form id slash plus b, where b can be a general potential. In other words, it's a multiplication operator, which is typically smooth and has nice decay properties at infinity. In this setting, we already constructed the kernel of the fermionic projector non-perturbatively using the fermionic signature operator. Let me briefly recall the main results of this analysis, because then I can explain you how to proceed perturbatively, so how to reformulate the construction in order to make a perturbative treatment possible. Okay, so in the construction of the fermionic signature operator, we considered families of solutions with a varying mass parameter. So the mass was in an interval I here. Well, I don't want to give all the details, so just the basics. So we had families of solutions. Then we integrated over the mass parameter. And this generated decay at infinity, making it possible to compute the space-time inner product, the Krein inner product, with another family, let's just call it psi m prime, dm prime. Okay, so this was well defined, and we proved that it can be represented as a single integral over the mass. And then we had here psi m, sm, psi prime m, m, dm. So here on the right side, we consider everything at the same mass m. This is the scalar product on the solution space. And the right side can be used to define the fermionic signature operator. And this was a bounded operator on the solution space, symmetric, which means that we have the spectral calculus to our disposal. In particular, one can introduce the negative spectral subspace, the projection operator, onto the negative spectral subspace of the fermionic signature operator. Good, so this made it possible to construct the kernel of the fermionic projector. And, well, let me also recall this construction in a slightly different way, which fits better to what will come next. Namely, I want to work with Green's operators already. I mean, we know that the initial value problem for the Dirac equation is well posed, which means that given an inhomogeneity, so suppose we consider the inhomogeneous Dirac equation, where phi is, say, smooth compact support, then we know that there is an advanced and a retarded solution. And let me now call this by, well, using Green's operators. So we introduce like SM, this is the advanced Green's operator, and then there's the retarded Green's operator, and they both map from C infinity 0 of MSM to C infinity spatially compact M, SM. The same here. So this is the advanced Green's operator. And the other is the retarded Green's operator. Of course, more computational details will come soon, but already now we know that this is well defined. Namely, the retarded solution is the solution which has its support in the future. So this is what we denoted in the previous video by psi plus, and the advanced solution is the one where the support goes to the future, which is what we denoted by psi minus. Okay, and then we introduce Km as 1 over 2 pi I times the advanced minus the retarded solution. And this is now a mapping from, again, test wave functions to spatially compact wave function. But now this maps to solutions, to homogeneous solutions of a Dirac equation. In other words, it maps to Hm. And this is what we call the causal fundamental solution. I mean, we already encounter this difference of advanced and retarded solutions, but we didn't introduce this notation Km, but this will come up all the time from now on. Okay, using this notion, how did we introduce the kernel of the fermionic projector? So this was done as follows. This is a bidistribution, so this means it depends here on two test wave functions. And this P of phi, phi prime, was defined as follows. We take Km phi. Okay, then we take here chi minus of Sm times chi m phi prime. And then we take here the scalar product, and well, let's not worry about the prefactor here. So there's a certain constant, which we will encounter in more detail later. Okay, so this was the definition, and this is the kernel of the fermionic projector, to be more precise, the unregularized kernel. Okay, good. Maybe I should quickly explain this. Note that this Km phi prime, this is the solution of the Dirac equation. So therefore, we are in the Hilbert space Hm. We can apply this projection operator. And then we still have a vector in the Hilbert space. On the left side, we also have a vector in the Hilbert space. And therefore, this scalar product is well defined. Okay, good. So these are the basic constructions. And the question is, well, how can we do this perturbatively? This is not so obvious. And in order to, well, see how to do it, it is good to return to the formula up here, which defined the fermionic signature operator, and to consider specific families. Namely, we consider the family psi m, which is obtained by taking a fixed test wave function and applying Km. And similarly, of course, phi prime m is equal to Km times phi prime. If we plug this in, then it's also good to, well, let's just compute formally. I mean, since we know that everything is well defined, non-perturbatively, so the task really here is to compute things, and therefore it's a good idea not to worry about all the technicalities here, because in the end everything will be defined only order by order anyhow, and we don't worry about convergence of the perturbation series. Well, knowing that everything is well defined non-perturbatively, there's no point in worrying about these details here. So therefore, let's simply take out these integrals And then we get the following: integral I dm, integral I dm prime, and then we have here the space-time inner product of km phi, km prime phi prime, and this is equal to the integral over I. Okay, then we have to write it like this. So now m is fixed and this signature operator sm comes up, and here we integrate over the mass. Okay, now let's consider this integrand here a bit more in detail. What we have here is an integral over space-time, and the kernel km here is symmetric, so therefore we can again formally bring this factor km to the other side. So this means that phi, or km phi, km prime phi prime is the same, well, I write here for clarity, so this is just a formal computation where we don't worry about existence of all these integrals. Then we get here km times km prime times phi prime. Good. And next one should keep in mind, well, there's a double integral on the left side, but there's only one integral on the right side. And this can also be understood that this product here gives us a delta distribution in m minus m prime. So more precisely, if we compute km times km prime, this should be delta of m minus m prime times something. Namely, if we take this as an ansatz and plug it in here, well, then one of the integrals disappears and we get something which looks quite similar to what we have here on the right side. Well, it doesn't quite fit right now because there's a factor km on the left side. This is something which we'll come to later. But, well, in simple terms, this here will be something like sm times km. We'll see this in more detail later. What's important right now is that here we get a product of the kernels of the corresponding integral operators in space-time. Let's write this out a bit more in detail. So this is like a product of integral operators in space-time. So this means km times km prime. So this is again a kernel, say, of x comma y, is the integral over Minkowski space km of x comma z times km prime of z comma y d for z. And our task is to make sense of such products in space-time, and this should also give rise to such factors delta of m minus m prime. Okay, so therefore, in other words, what we need to do is we need a spectral calculus in space-time. Well, I mean, spectral calculus on a Hilbert space, no problem, but then it's just a spectral calculus on a hypersurface, on a Cauchy surface. But that's not what we want to do here. We want to really do a spectral calculus in space-time. Okay, and in fact, this factor delta of m minus m prime, this can also be understood in similar terms. Namely, one can say that we want to consider the Dirac operator as an operator on wave functions in space-time and do a spectral calculus for the Dirac operator. This is a related concept. Let me explain this a little bit. Spectral calculus for the operator D in space-time. So this means the idea is the following. Well, we have the Dirac equation, and now we regard M as an eigenvalue of the Dirac operator. And of course, it's an eigenvalue equation. So therefore, why not try to find a spectral decomposition of this Dirac operator? Also in an external potential, for example, what are the spectral projections of the Dirac operator? So this means, let me just write this formally. I mean, so like the goal is that the D can be written as the integral over M dEm, and this would then be like a spectral projection operator where the mass is the spectral parameter. Okay, so this is something I had in mind already more than 30 years ago, but this cannot be realized in a rigorous mathematical sense, because the Dirac operator is an operator on a Krein space. So this is where then we have spectral calculus on indefinite inner product spaces. And this is not easy. I mean, there are results in Pontryagin spaces, and there is a spectral theorem in Krein spaces, but it requires additional assumptions. The spectral doesn't need to, for symmetric operators, doesn't need to be real. Everything is much more difficult, and therefore this cannot be, at least I couldn't do it, and I don't think it's a good idea to even try to do this. This cannot be realized, say, with mathematical rigor, or say mathematically. Because D acts on an indefinite inner product space. Well, in fact, it's a symmetric operator. On the indefinite inner product space, where this is again our Krein space. With the Krein inner product, of course, like again, this space-time inner product. Let me illustrate this spectral calculus in space-time by considering the vacuum Dirac equation. And I want to do things a bit more computational anyhow, so let's just do some computations. Suppose we have no external potential, and then the question is, what are the spectral projections here? What is this DEM? Can one write this down? And this is in fact possible, and of course in the Minkowski vacuum, it's good to work in Fourier space. And then it turns out that DEM is PM DM, where PM is the following distribution. I mean, it's supported on the mass shell because it should be a solution of the eigensolutions of a Dirac equation. And more precisely, I mean, we denote the Fourier variable K. So then this Pm of K is equal to K slash plus M times delta of K square minus M square. Let's verify this, and to this end, we need to, well, what do we want to verify? I mean, of course, the spectral projection operators, they should satisfy the usual relation. So EU times EV should be EU cap V. And this means for the PMs that PM times PM prime should be delta of M minus M prime times PM. So this is what orthogonality of the different eigenspaces means. But of course, it's all now here in the continuous setting. So we have a continuous spectrum. The mass is a continuous variable. And this is why we need to use this delta normalization, as physicists would call it. Okay, let's just compute this. Pm of k times Pm prime of k. This is k slash plus m times k slash plus m prime times delta of k square minus m square times delta of k prime squared minus m square. Okay, now we want to compute, so let's not worry about mathematical subtleties. Well, here we get a contribution only if k square is equal to m square. Well, and therefore, we can... No, sorry, I made something wrong here. Of course, it should be k square minus m prime squared, sorry. There is no k prime. K square minus m prime squared. Okay, now it's correct. Here we get a contribution only if k square is equal to m squared. So therefore, we can simply replace the k square here by m squared. So then we get k slash plus m times k slash plus m prime times m squared minus m delta of m squared minus m prime squared times delta of k squared minus m squared. Okay, now what is this delta of m square minus m prime squared? Well, there are two contributions, so we get something like 1 over 2 absolute value of m times, well, and then either m is equal to m prime, or m is minus m prime. Good, and then man can, well, let's only consider the case where m and m prime are positive, just to simplify the computation. Then, of course, this term here is out, and also we can drop the absolute value. Therefore, what we get is 1 over 2m. And then the good thing is we already have this desired delta of m minus m prime. Now we multiply these Dirac matrices out, which gives k slash squared is of course k squared using the anti-commutation relations, plus then the mixed terms are m plus m prime times k slash plus m times m prime times delta of k squared minus m squared. Okay, now of course here we can set k squared is equal to m squared. Moreover, m is equal to m prime. Therefore, this is equal to 2m. This is equal to m squared. And then we can factor out a factor 2m. So that we get 1 over 2m times delta of m minus m prime times 2m times k slash plus m times delta of k square minus m squared. Well, and then of course these factors 2m drop out, and what we have here is again the pm. So therefore we get the desired relation. We really get delta of m minus m prime times pm. Good, so therefore we can view these PMs as spectral projections of the Dirac operator in Minkowski space. I should say already here one has to be careful because there's no completeness relation here. I mean, if you integrate here only over the real numbers, then this does not hold. There's also an imaginary spectrum. But this can, I mean, on the from the computational side, this can be done. So this means for the vacuum Dirac operator, there is no real problem here. But as I said, once you perturb this, then it is not clear what this spectral decomposition should be. There is no, well, functional analytic framework which would justify this spectral decomposition. And also we don't really need it. I mean, here is just to explain that what we did here, I mean, we can really multiply together distributions in space-time and we get the desired M minus M prime. This is quite similar to what we had in mind up here. Km times Km prime should also be delta of M minus M prime times something. And in fact, let us now compute this something again in the Minkowski vacuum. Well, and then I'll explain you the general strategy for the perturbative treatment. Good. So first of all, maybe I should also give you formulas for the Green's operators. Well, and these are the same formulas which you find in all the physics textbooks. So let me write this down. First of all, we again work in momentum space, which means that the kernel in position space is written as a Fourier integral, integral d4k over 2 pi to the fourth times sm of k times e to the minus ik of times x minus y. And then, well, there is the advanced and the retarded Green's operator. And let's begin with the advanced Green's operator. This has the form k slash plus m divided by k squared minus m squared minus I delta k zero. And then we let k zero, delta to zero in the distributional sense. And similarly, the advanced Green's operator is, well, the same formula, but with plus I delta k zero. Okay, as I said, these are the standard formulas. In fact, in physics textbooks, it's usually written like this, 1 over k slash minus m, which shows you it's the inverse of the Dirac operator. It's the propagator. Well, and with this procedure here, with this, in this way, we prescribe the poles in the complex plane, and this is how causality is built in. More precisely, if one looks at the poles of these expressions here in the complex K0 plane, then the poles are either in both in the upper or both in the lower half plane. And depending on whether one is in the x0 minus y0 is positive or negative, one can close the K0 integral in the upper or in the lower half plane. And then one gets zero in one of the cases, and this shows what causality is. And let me draw a picture also to explain this notation here with these triangles or wedges, because this is to be understood as follows. Suppose we have x here, and then we plot y in the plane, then the support of the retarded Green's operator is inside the lower light cone. So therefore, of course, I mean, this wedge here corresponds to the lower light cone. And of course, likewise, the Advanced Screens Operator has its support here. So this is the support of SM of x, dot. Okay, so this is how to understand this notation. Good, now what about this KM? This was defined as prefactor, well, 1 over 2 pi I times the advanced minus the retarded Green's operator. And now we can use the formulas for the advanced and retarded Green's functions and apply this distributional formula 1 over x minus I epsilon minus 1 over x plus I epsilon, and the limit epsilon to 0 gives us 2 pi I times the delta distribution. And doing this, one gets here something which is again supported on the mass shell, as it should be, because the Km is a solution of the Dirac equation. And more precisely, what we get here is k slash plus m times delta of k squared minus m squared times, well, and then there comes here sine function epsilon of k zero. Good, and now we can compute Km times Km prime, similar to what we just for with Pm. The only difference is that there's this additional sine function coming up, but it comes twice, and therefore these two sine functions cancel, and what we get is the same as what we got above. So we again get, let's see, delta of m minus m prime times Pm. And this way we have like a nice functional calculus. And one can also say what the Sm is, namely Sm is simply 1 on the upper and minus 1 on the lower mass shell, namely it's simply like this epsilon of k0. This is then the same as the fermionic signature operator. Of course, this works only in the vacuum. What about if we now perturb things? And let me first of all give you an outline of how this is done. So now comes the perturbative treatment. The strategy is as follows. Well, now we have, of course, the Dirac operator plus the potential, and we treat this potential as a perturbation order by order. Well, and then, first of all, for the Green's operators, there is a unique perturbation expansion, which is pretty standard, where we use the support properties. So the SM tilde here, so always the tilde objects are in the presence of the external potential, and the S tilde, so they are, this is like a standard perturbation expansion. I'll show you more details soon. Well, then we can again form K tilde M as 1 over 2 pi I times the difference of the advanced and retarded Green's operator, just as in the unperturbed situation. Okay, and then the question is, what is Km tilde times Km tilde prime? And this is what gives Sm prime, and then we can use the spectral calculus. In order to develop this spectral calculus for K tilde M in an efficient and systematic way, it is good to work with contour integrals. which involve the resolvent. The resolvent is denoted by R lambda, and doing all this gives a unique perturbation expansion, explicit perturbation expansion for the kernel of the fermionic projector in the presence of the external potential. Okay, let me now enter the details a bit more. I mean, not all the details, you find it all in the blue book, for example, but let me just be a bit more, well, just explain a few more details which might help you to the reading of the book. First of all, what is this standard perturbation expansion of the Green's operators? Well, this can be derived as follows. So let's write down the defining equation of the Green's operator. Namely, it should be an inhomogeneous solution of a Dirac equation with a delta source on the right side, or in other words, it's just like the inverse of a Dirac operator. Acting with the Dirac operator on the Green's operator should be the identity. Okay, and now it is good to write it like this. So we write it as id slash minus m plus b times sm tilde is equal to the identity. And now we multiply both sides with the Green's operator in the vacuum. And when we do this, well, then of course we get the Green's operator on the right side. On the left side, we can multiply this out, and then we get here 1 plus Sm b times Sm tilde. Good, and now we can invert the operator on the left. So this is the identity plus something small. I mean, this is what the idea of perturbative treatment, this piece is very small. Therefore, this is a perturbation. Well, and such an operator can always be inverted with a Neumann series, namely this 1 plus SMB to the power minus 1 is the sum p equal to 0 to infinity minus SMB to the power p. So just a geometric series, Neumann series. I mean, I guess you're familiar with this. If we multiply on both sides, we get an explicit formula for SM tilde. Namely, this is then the sum p equals 0 to infinity minus SMB to the power p times SM. Now the question is like, which Green's operators do we use? I mean, we have like the advanced and the retarded guy. Suppose we want to compute the retarded Green's operator, then the right prescription is to work always with the retarded Green's operators, because only in this way causality is respected. So this is a requirement in order to get the desired support properties. So this ensures the causal structure or support properties, causal support properties. Namely, let's consider this, let me explain this just to first order. I mean, higher orders are the same. So first order, we have here minus the Green's operator times B times the Green's operator. Now let's write this out, this operator product. So this is an integral over D4Z. Then we have here Sm of X, Z. Well, we assumed that B was a multiplication operator. times sm of z, y. And here we can consider the support properties as follows. I mean, suppose we have here the point x. Then we know that the first Green's operator is supported if z lies in the past light cone centered at x. So this means this, let's just do it in yellow. Now this is the support of this Green's operator. Well, and then we have a point y here. So in other words, the black dot here is z. So this is what we plot. Say y is here. Then we can also plot the support of the other Green's operator. One has to keep in mind that y is the second argument. This is why the support looks just the other way around. So this means now it looks like this. So let me say, so this is the support of the retarded Green's operator of x, dot, and this is the support of the advanced Green's operator of dot, y. Okay, and then we see, like, if x and y are space-like separated, we get zero because the supports do not interact. Similarly, if y lies in the future of x, also we get zero. So therefore, we only get a contribution if x lies here and y lies here. And then we get an integral only over this intersection region, so only over this diamond here. So therefore, one sees that this combination here, SMB, SM of XY, is supported in the past light cone. Maybe I put here dot, is supported in the past light cone as desired. And of course, higher order, similarly, you can just do it iteratively. Okay, so this is the perturbation expansion for the Green's operators. I should also say this is well-defined order by order, provided that B has nice decay properties. In fact, at this stage, it's not even necessary to have decay properties, but later on we need it anyhow. This is why in the blue book you find everything is well-defined, provided B, whatever, is twice differentiable and decays suitably at infinity. We do not care about the convergence of the series here. On the other hand, this is not really an issue because we know that these causal Green's operators are well-defined non-perturbatively as well, simply by solving the Cauchy problem. Okay. So once we have the Green's operators, we also know what this k tilde m is, just the difference of the two Green's operators. And now let's move on to this functional calculus in space-time. It is it's good to have a convenient notation. Then we leave out m and write the multiplication with a dot. Why? Well, the point is that we leave out these distributions, these factors delta of m minus m prime. And we also leave out this delta m minus m prime. And in order to clarify the notation, we put a dot. So this means we have, like, for the unperturbed guys, then we have the formulas p dot p is equal to p. Then we have k dot k is also equal to p. So these are the formulas which we had earlier. And moreover, we have p dot k is equal to k dot p is equal to k. So we have such quite simple relations. These formulas can be understood as follows. P is a projection operator, and K here has eigenvalues plus and minus 1, namely K square is the same as P, and well, this also is reflected here. This means that we can form the resolvent, the unperturbed resolvent, R lambda. This is defined by K minus lambda to the power minus 1. And we can write out an explicit formula using that we know the eigenvalues already. Namely, we have the eigenvalue 1. So therefore, we get 1 over 1 minus lambda times the projector on the eigenspace is simply P plus K over 2. Then we have the eigenvalue minus 1, which gives us then 1 over minus 1 minus lambda times P minus K over 2. Well, and then there might be a kernel of the operator P, which gives the term 1 over minus lambda times 1 minus P. So this way we have the unperturbed resolvent. Now, how can this be perturbed? First of all, we have K tilde M, the distribution, well, the difference of the perturbed advanced and retarded Green's operators. Well, and this can be written as the unperturbed operator plus the perturbation. Let me just write down the first term here. So we get here SM BKM, or minus, in fact, minus SM BKM minus KM BSM plus whatever, second, third order, and so on. And here the SM is the mean of the advanced and retarded Green's operator. 1/2 advanced plus retarded. This is what we also call the symmetric Green's operator. In fact, it's a symmetric operator with respect to the Kreininer product. Good, so this is how the perturbation expansion looks like. And now we denote this whole perturbation by delta K. So therefore, we write this as Km plus delta Km. Good, now we again leave out the index M and use the above computation rules. This means that we again leave out delta of m minus m prime and we denote multiplication with a dot. So this means we have k tilde is equal to k plus delta k. And this makes it possible to also compute the perturbed resolvent order by order as follows. So we write R tilde lambda, this is K tilde minus lambda to the power minus 1. Okay, then we can write this as K minus lambda plus delta K to the power minus 1. Now we can use this usual Neumann series trick. So we factor out R minus lambda. So let's do it in detail. So we write this as K minus lambda times R times 1 plus K minus lambda to the minus 1, but this is the R lambda which we computed above, plus R lambda times delta K to the power minus, well, everything here to the power minus 1. Well, then the inverse of the product is the product of the inverses, but we have to flip the order of multiplication. Therefore, we get here 1 plus R lambda delta K to the power minus 1 times R lambda. Well, and now we can use this Neumann series expansion. So we get the sum P equals 0 to infinity minus R lambda delta k to the power p times r lambda. Good. So this is what we get here, and I should have put in dots wherever necessary. Namely, all these. So here I should put a dot, and then there are dots here as well. So we always use the above computation rules, and we always get factors of delta of m minus m prime, which we leave out. Okay, good. So this is now the perturbed resolvent, and now we can perform a functional calculus. Namely, how does this look like? Well, we already computed the spectrum of the unperturbed operator, so sigma of k, and we saw that we have the eigenvalues 1, minus 1, and possibly 0. If you perturb the operator, so we consider the spectrum of k tilde, let's do this in green, well then the spectrum, the eigenvalues change a little bit because we do it perturbatively, so this means the eigenvalues will be somewhere like here, could also be around here. Okay, and now we choose a contour which encloses the whole spectrum. Say whatever, let's take such a contour. So this is gamma. And then we can introduce a functional calculus as follows. So we introduce f of k tilde. So this is defined by the integral over the contour gamma, f of lambda times r tilde lambda d lambda. And well, then there's a prefactor 1 over 2 pi I. So this is the usual way to write a functional calculus using contour integrals. For example, you find this in Cato's book for matrices or for operators in Hilbert spaces. It's the same formulas here. However, one should keep in mind that we use our multiplication rules with the dot. And everything here is well defined to every order in perturbation theory. And as I already mentioned, since we already have a non-perturbative construction, everything is rigorous, mathematically well defined anyhow. This is why if it comes down to, well, how can we compute things, it is perfectly fine to just work with, well, formal power series in the external potential, or we consider things order by order in perturbation theory, and then to every order everything is well defined and finite. So this is the level on which we are working here. Good, so this is a functional calculus where f is holomorphic, say. Holomorphic function in the interior of the contour. Okay, the nice thing is that we have the relations we want. Then maybe first of all we have the resolvent identity. Namely r lambda times r tilde lambda dot r tilde lambda prime is equal to, how is it, 1 over lambda minus lambda prime. I always get mixed up with the signs. R lambda tilde minus r tilde lambda prime. Let's see, is this correct? Yes. And as a consequence, also the functional calculus identity holds. So this means if we take f of k tilde dot g of k tilde, this is the same as f times g of k tilde. This means now we have really a functional calculus for operators in space-time. Well, this is for operators on a Krein space, but nevertheless, order by order and perturbation theory, everything is well defined and we have all the computation rules we want. Good, now finally, how can we introduce p tilde? And let me first of all explain this by starting from k tilde. Of course, k tilde is the identity, or the function, well, let's write it in more detail. Minus 1 over 2 pi I integral over gamma lambda times r tilde lambda d lambda. Well, this is clear from the functional calculus. Now we only want the negative spectral subspace of k tilde because, well, as I explained above, I mean, the functional calculus for k tilde is the same as the functional calculus for the fermionic signature operator S, except that one operator is on the Krein space, the other on the Hilbert space. But nevertheless, the negative spectral subspace of the fermionic signature operator amounts to considering the negative spectral subspace of k tilde. And this is how one can understand that p tilde is equal to 1 over 2 pi I integral gamma, well, then there's a minus sign, minus lambda. And now we integrate here over a contour which only encloses the eigenvalue minus 1. Okay, so this contour gamma minus looks like this. So this is the definition of the fermionic projector, which is then a well-defined distribution, again order by order in the external potential. Good, I think that's more or less all I wanted to say, but I wanted to conclude with two remarks. So first of all, why is it called causal perturbation expansion? The reason is that it is all based on the perturbation expansion for the advanced and retarded Green's operators. And this was causal. I mean, recall these pictures here with these light cones and so on. So, I mean, the perturbation expansion for S, for the advanced and retarded Green's operators, this was causal. And this is the reason for the name, causal perturbation expansion. Okay, causal here means, so it is based on the perturbation expansion for the advanced and retarded Green's functions, and this in fact respects causality. Nevertheless, the resulting expansion is not causal. So this means the expansion for this p tilde here. So p tilde really depends on the external potential in all of space-time. So there's no causality. And in fact, we will see this in more detail in the next video on the light cone expansion. So basically, generally speaking, this p tilde has contributions which respect causality, but there are other contributions which do not respect causality. Nevertheless, kind of the singular structure on the light cone, this does respect causality. This is another, well, also the reason why it's a good name to call it causal perturbation expansion. I should point out, so it's called causal because it's based on the causal expansion for the Green's operators. We do not use the Feynman propagator or any other prescription for performing a perturbation expansion. This would be a different perturbation expansion, which would not be causal. And as a consequence, also the light cone expansion would not have these nice causality properties, which I will explain in the next video. Okay, and finally, another issue is, what about the normalization? Of the kernel of the fermionic projector. Well, in fact, this is something which developed over the years. I started with what I called a space-time normalization or mass normalization. And later I used spatial normalization because this seems to be the right thing. This seems to be better. And this spatial normalization, this is also what is implemented in this formula here. This means that if I take this p tilde of x comma z times gamma 0 times p tilde of z, y, and then I integrate this over space, then I get a certain prefactor, I think 1 over 2 pi, doesn't really matter, times p tilde of x, y. Okay, in fact, the same normalization condition also holds for the causal fundamental solution. In fact, similarly, k tilde of xz times gamma 0 times k tilde of z, y, d3y is equal to 1 over 2 pi times k tilde of x, y, and maybe here I should put in index m again. So this can also be understood directly, namely, if one considers the kernel as an operator on the Hilbert space at a fixed time, then k is simply the identity. So in other words, it's like a maps on the whole solution space, and it's just a projection onto the solution space. This is how this formula can be understood. And then finally, using this formula, one can also make the connection to the definition which I had at the very beginning of this lecture. Let me go back. Where did we start from? Well, we started with, let's see, where is it? Like here, we started with this formula here, with this definition of the fermionic projector. Let's copy this at the very end, and then I'll explain what the connection to our new definition is. Okay, if we take into account that we have this spatial normalization, then what we have here, so we have here our spatial integral, just like the scalar product in the Hilbert space, and we have here Km, and here we have another operator. This Km is simply the identity. This is what we verified here. So therefore, I can also write this as whatever, maybe C over 2 pi times, well, and then we get the Krein inner product. Then we get here phi. And then we can leave out this factor of Km. Chi minus of Sm Km phi prime, okay, and no index m anymore because it's just a space-time inner product. This is well-defined because phi and phi prime here are both compactly supported in space-time. Good, and now we can compare the formulas. You see that this formula here, so this is what is p here, and, well, this harmonizes now with the definition here, namely we can also write this here simply as chi minus times k tilde. Okay, of course the notation is, well, here we use a somewhat different notation. Maybe I should add tildes everywhere, and then sm tilde, and then p tilde. But I hope that you see how everything fits together and also how one gets the connection between the non-perturbative construction, the non-perturbative definition, and on the other hand, here a formula which can be written out order by order, and you get explicit formulas to every order. And, well, in fact, this is what is the causal perturbation expansion. I think I should have pointed out here that this has an explicit form. We have here explicit formulas, uniquely defined to every order. Okay, and I think let's stop here. In the next video, I will start from these explicit formulas and explain how to get information on how the kernel of the fermionic projector looks like in space-time. Okay, good. So thanks and see you again soon.